Or think according to the power that has been released to dwell within us. Father, we have invited you, we have called your attention to the aches and pain. Father, we have called your attention to the miseries we are going through. We have called your attention to issues of our lives that have refused to be repaired. We have called your attention to arguments that have cost us so much sorrow, pains that have cost us sorrow, issues that have refused to go. So this morning, Father, the intention of calling your attention is that we deliberately reported those situations to you, knowing that as we report those situations, the God of heaven will dispatch his angel.
Amen.
He will dispatch his angel.
Amen.
To start the repair.
Amen.
To touch the areas that are aching.
Amen.
To bring relief.
Amen.
To cancel the pain.
Amen.
To overrun the pain.
Amen.
To put an end to the pain.
Amen.
To put an end to the sorrow.
Amen.
To put the enemy to shame.
Amen.
We ask that you will rule over every one of us.
Amen.
Spirit of the living God,
amen.
Glorify the Father,
amen.
Glorify the Son,
amen.
In this meeting, in the name of Jesus,
amen.
Every stubborn spirit, we command that you come under the authority and lordship of the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you, Father. Thank you because you've had us. Blessed be your holy name, Lord. The meeting is yours, Lord. Take all the glory. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' precious name, we have prayed. In Jesus' powerful name, we have prayed.
Amen.
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 Somebody shout. Presence of God. And please be seated. Thank you. The Lord bless everyone that is here. Can I get an amen for you? The prayers that we made, it was deliberate. I wanted you to use your own mouth to report the situation that you are going through to God. I wanted God to get involved as you tell him again. I'm sure some of you have ministered, you've told the Lord severally, but this is one unique day that you will never be in a hurry to forget.
Amen.
That's why I have asked you, I have pleaded with you in the manner of speaking to again let God into that area of your life that is not adding up, that requires a divine repair, that requires a divine touch, that requires God himself to take it away. I am persuaded that there's a God in heaven who answers prayers. And I know that God will answer your prayer. In fact, let me put it this way. I am persuaded. Because God, the Bible says, whatsoever we speak into his ears, that will he do. Someone has spoken into the ears of God this morning.
Amen.
I did. I don't know about you.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
He says, whatever you speak into my ears, meaning what? God has ears and he listens. And when he listens, he is also moved to act. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
When physically you speak to someone and he refuses to act, that suggests to you that maybe that person is not interested in you, or that he's ignored you, or that you don't mean much to him. Isn't it?
Yes.
You come to someone, you tell him, you discuss with him, you have what you regard as an excellent conversation that requires an action. The next thing you do, you see is that the guy folds his hand, sits down, or just walks away. My brothers and sisters, that scenario paints a picture either that the guy is not interested in you, or that the things you have said is useless, or does not make sense, or that he just doesn't want you around him. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
But my brothers and sisters, the Bible tells me that I'm the apple of God's own eye. The Bible tells me that God is concerned about me. The Bible tells me that he will do exceedingly abundantly than what I'm able to ask or think, according to the power he has released. The Bible tells me that God is interested in my life. Therefore, whatsoever I speak into his ears, he will not abandon those things. He will take action about those things. Is anyone on the same page as I am?
Yes.
God will take action regarding what you have, you know, what you have spoken to him. Is anyone who believes that God will not attend to you today? He will attend to you tomorrow. He will attend to you next week. He will attend to you next year. Is anyone who believes that God will attend to, he will attend to his case this moment?
Yes.
Shout hallelujah. This morning, I'd like to share with you what I call anointing for change. Anointing that creates a change. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Anointing that creates what? A change. If I ask my sister who is seated in front, and I ask her to move from where she is seated to this place, she would move. What that means is that there has been a change in her sitting position. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
A change assumed something has happened. Something positive has happened. A change can also mean something negative has happened. But my brothers and sisters, your change will be positive.
Amen.
Your change will be exciting.
Amen.
Your change will be glorious.
Amen.
Your change will be permanent.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Let me start this way. Change, let me tell you what change is not. Change is this. But change is also not this. So let's start from what change is not. Amen?
Amen.
Praise the God.
Hallelujah.
Change is not chameleonic. You know, a chameleon. How many of you know what that little animal called a chameleon? Praise the God.
Hallelujah.
A chameleon changes its color with the environment. When you see a chameleon, if the environment is brown, the chameleon will take a brown color. If the environment is red and the surrounding is red, the chameleon will assume a red color. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
So change is not chameleonic. It's not a chameleon in nature, nor shape. Change is not a thermometer. Change is not a thermostat. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
You know why it's not a chameleon? A chameleon will change his own skin. Maybe you see your group of friends and you decide to shape up. You decide to sit properly and behave properly. As soon as those groups of friends are gone, then you are just yourself and say, oh boy, don't mind them, they long go. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. You know, these days our children are great actors. Our children at home, they're great actors. They come from school and they act for you. And you say, oh, what a wonderful child. Praise the Lord. In fact, if you put water in their mouth, the water will stay there. And say, keep water there, water will stay there. But as soon as they leave where their parents are, and they get into where their folks are, where their guys are, you will never believe it. That it's the same boy who was acting, you know, like the drama now. He was acting the drama at home. He was always patient, always nice. Yes, daddy, yes, mommy. Yeah. Mommy, can I help you in the kitchen? But the next minute when he's no longer in that kind of environment, he becomes another person. That's not the kind of change we're talking about. That change is what we call chameleonic. Amen?
Amen.
Every child of God that whose change is driven by the nature of a chameleon is not truly a Christian. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
If you have encountered God, your change remains a permanent change. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. The number two, change is not chameleonic. Change is not a thermometer. Change is not a thermostat. Number three, change is not fake. Change is not what?
Fake.
It's not fake. Praise the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. Now, before we go to change is not fake, look at Galatians chapter 2, verse 11. Galatians chapter 2, verse 11. There's an incident there that I'd like to point your attention to. But when Peter was come to Antioch, I withstood him to the face, because he was to live. For before that certain came from James, he did eat with the Gentiles. But when they were come, he withdrew and separated himself, fearing them which were of the circumcision. And the other Jews dissembled likewise with him in so much that Barnabas also was carried away with their dissimulation. But when I saw that they walked not uprightly according to the truth of the gospel, I said unto Peter before them all, if thou being a Jew livest after the manner of Gentiles, and not as do the Jews, why compellest thou the Gentiles to live as do the Jews? We who are Jews by nature are not sinners of the Gentiles, knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but that by the faith of Jesus Christ. Even we have believed in Christ, in Jesus Christ, that we might be justified by faith of Christ and not by the works of the law. For by the works of the law shall no flesh be justified. Now, the story is very exciting story. Peter, one of the apostles, he was relating eating with the Gentiles. In those days, Gentiles and the Jews never stayed together. They never eat together. It was like at the time, those days in America, when white and blacks cannot sit together. The blacks are referred to as Negroes. The blacks are referred to as baboons. We're referred to as apes. They are the special breed of God. Can you imagine? Praise the Lord. But because most of the blacks that were brought in from Africa. So there was segregation. And so that was the kind of situation that you had in Israel. The Jews cannot sit with the Gentiles. Gentiles were supposed to be sinners. Gentiles were ungodly people. Gentiles were unrighteous people. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Now, but for those who were converted by faith, Peter came, and because they were supposed to be his brothers, he started to, before the apostles came, he was eating with them and he was talking with them. As soon as the apostles came, who were Jews, he decided to separate himself. Hallelujah. That's not the kind of change. That's a chameleonic change. That's a change that is influenced, that's more like a thermometer kind of change. And that's not the kind of change that Christianity speaks about, that Christ has come to release to us as children of God. Praise the Lord. The second point is, change is not fake. Change is for real people. Help me tap your neighbor and say, neighbor.
Neighbor.
Are you a real person?
Are you a real person?
Has God changed you?
Has God changed you?
Neighbor, answer him.
Yes.
God has changed me. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Give me Galatians chapter 6, verse 7a. Galatians chapter 6, verse 7a. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. For whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he reap. Give me 8. For he that soweth to his flesh shall of his flesh do what? Reap corruption. But he that soweth to the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap everlasting life. Hallelujah.
Amen.
God is not mocked. Change is real. You cannot pretend to be a Christian. You can pretend to be somebody. But somehow along the line, after a while, things will catch up with you. Amen?
Amen.
Whatever you pretend you are not, eventually your true color, your true personality will emerge. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Jesus Christ lives in us. The Bible says he lives in us, he walks in us, and he drives us to do the things we do. Anyone who has not the Spirit of God in him is left dry and empty. So change is real, change is not fake. Praise the Lord. Whatsoever a man doeth, he would reap, whether now or later. The elders say to us, the elders say that there's a saying that when you do something, it does not vanish. It's just kept for a while in a secret place for a while. My brothers and sisters, after a while, whatever it is done would emerge. It will become open to everyone. The Almighty God will help us in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Now, so we see that change is not chameleonic. Change is not a thermometer. Change is not a thermostat. Change is not fake. Change is real. And I know that I'm going through all of this because one of you, or all of you, or some of you will experience divine change.
Amen.
And when you experience change, you will know you have experienced change. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
In John chapter 20, verse, reading from verse 24, there's a story there about Jesus and Thomas. But Thomas, one of the 12, called Didymus. When someone calls like a demonic person, praise the Lord, he calls himself Didymus. Thomas, called Didymus, was not with them when Jesus came. The other disciples therefore said unto him, we have seen the Lord. But he said unto them, except I shall see his hand, the print of the nails, and put my fingers into the print of the nails, and thrust my hand into his side, I will not believe. And after 8 days again, his disciples were within, and Thomas with them. Then came Jesus, the door being shut, and stood in the midst and said, peace be unto you. Then said he to Thomas, reach hither thy finger, and behold my hands, and reach hither thy hand, and thrust it into my side, and be not faithless, but be what?
Believe.
Believe. And Thomas answered and said unto him, my Lord and my God. Change is real. Jesus went to the cross of Calvary. His hands were nailed to the cross. And when the disciples reported that they saw Jesus, he said it could not be Jesus you saw. It would just be an apparition. It might just be, you know, it might just be a spirit. Didymus said, until I see those marks, until I can put my finger into those marks, I will not believe. And because the change has happened, the man who went to the cross, the change, the nails are there on his legs, and the piercing on his side were still there. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. That's why I say change is what? Is real. If the change were not real, when the demons came and demanded, I want to be able to look at his hand, the holes in his hand. I want to be able to see where he was, the sword pierced his side. If he was not real, if Jesus was not real, there would not have been anything to show. But thank God, you, my brothers and sisters, that our faith in him is real. And that Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, is also real. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
That's one lesson. The other lesson that Jesus Christ passed across to Didymus, he said, blessed is he that has not seen, yet does what?
Believe.
And that's where I'm going this morning, my brothers and sisters. For the things you would receive from the Lord, God is not seated or standing in front of you, but you believe that his word to you will come to pass. He says, where two or three are gathered in his name, there he will be in their midst. So I believe that God is here in this room. I believe that God is in this meeting. How many of you believe that God is here in this meeting? Shout hallelujah. In this meeting, he has come to do you, to do something great and good for you. Hallelujah.
Right.
And as you believe that the things that you are asking him, he will bring them to pass, God will cause those things to come to realities in your life in the name of Jesus.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Now what we've talked about change. Because I want you to, I don't want you to leave this hall and say, I don't know what has happened to me. Something would happen to you either in this hall or after this meeting in the name of Jesus. Yeah. To be very clear, like the guy who gave testimony, he said, ladies and gentlemen, once I was blind, now I see. Change has occurred. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Anointing simply means the move of the Holy Spirit, the presence of God on a particular situation that will cause that situation to change, to change. What causes a change? So many things can cause a change. Your status in life can change as a result of getting an enhanced job. Your status in life, they will refer to you as daddy. They will refer to mommy as mommy. Praise the Lord. Your status have changed. Praise the Lord. When you wear a nice suit, they refer to you and say, they compliment you and say that you're wearing a nice dress. Praise the Lord. Status can change as a result of very many factors. But the kind of change I'm talking about is a divine change that is orchestrated, that is released from heaven. That change is permanent. Yes. And that change is driven by the power of the Holy Spirit. Yes. Hallelujah. Yes. The vehicle, the one who drives the change of heaven, the Holy Ghost is the agent of change and causes such permanent change to our car. Money can cause change. Your car can cause change. Your family can cause a change. Relocating from Ajiman to Dubai is also a change. Relocating from Dubai to Australia is what? A change. But all of those things are temporary change. But the permanent change is driven by what? The agent of change himself, the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. When Jesus was starting his ministry, the Holy Spirit, he needed the power and presence of the Holy Spirit. Don't also forget that the Holy Spirit is the third person in the Trinity. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, they are always the Trinity in council. Hallelujah. In the beginning in Genesis, we saw that God did what? Created. God the Father created. And then Jesus Christ came on the scene. And when Jesus left in John chapter 6, he said, I will send you a comforter who will reveal the mind of the Father and my mind to you, and he will teach you all things. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
He will rebuke you of the truth. He will convey to you what is truth, and he will help you to be able to serve the Father and serve the Holy Spirit and also interpret his word to us. So we see that the influence and works of the Holy Spirit is great. Hallelujah. And so when Jesus started his ministry, let's look at Mark chapter 1 verse 10. Mark chapter 1 verse 10. When he started his ministry. And straightway, brethren, straightway, everybody says straightway.
Straightway.
Coming out of the water, he saw no. All I wanted is say straightway. Praise the Lord. So that I know that you are with me. Praise the Lord. One more time, say straightway.
Straightway.
Thank you. Good student. Hallelujah. Coming out of the water, he saw the heaven opened and the Spirit like a dove descending upon him. Who was the dove descending upon?
The Holy Spirit.
Huh? Who was the Holy Spirit? And then, okay, maybe some of you, let's read the second verse. And there came a voice from heaven saying, Thou art my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Who is God's own beloved Son?
Jesus.
So the Spirit of God came upon him. You know, the heavens opened. In the name of the God I serve, your heavens will remain open. You will not pray on that open heaven. You will not operate on that closed heaven. In the name of Jesus. Your business will not be on that closed heaven. Your life will not be on that closed heaven. Your children will not be on that closed heaven. Your ministry will not be on that closed heaven. At all time, in all places, the heavens will open up to you. In the name of Jesus. When the heavens open, the Bible says the Holy Spirit did what? Came upon Jesus. And the voice rang out of heaven. And that voice said, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus, that Spirit that adorned the life of Jesus will also adorn your life. Will also come into your life. And when the Spirit comes into your life, you become a special person. You become an unstoppable person. Yes. You become someone that the Father will always, he will stand by you. He will stand on your right. He will stand on your left. He will stand behind you. And you will become, you will not be able, you won't fear anything fearless. My brothers and sisters, you've always seen children. When their fathers are around them, they can taunt even a Goliath. They can point at someone who is bigger and stronger than them. The reason is simple. That he is what? That he is around. Come and touch me now. He will tell, come and touch me now. If you can, come and touch me. But when he's alone, will he dare it? No. My brothers and sisters, God, the Father, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords is always with you. The devil cannot touch you. The devil is a small fry, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Somebody shout hallelujah. The anointing is just the presence of the Holy Spirit that we saw came upon Jesus. In Acts chapter 10, he says how God anointed Jesus Christ of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power. And he went about doing good, healing all who were oppressed, for God was with him. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. In Acts chapter 10, verse 38, how God did what? Anointed Jesus Christ of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power. Somebody shout power.
Power!
God anointed Jesus. And that anointing we saw in Mark chapter 1. The heavens opened and the Holy Spirit did what? Came upon him. And from that moment, what happened to him? He had the Holy Ghost and he had what?
Power.
And the Bible says he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed of the devil. For God is with him. Today, as the anointing that represents the presence, is just a representation. The anointing is just a representation. That anointing conveys the power and potency and energy of God. Hallelujah. Amen. When it rests upon you, the Spirit of God begins to act. Hallelujah. Amen. When you take Panadol, my brother, you ingest Panadol. Do you open up your tumor and say, let me see how it begins to work? The ingredient that will make it work and attack headache and pain, it's already put in it. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. That oil carries the power and energy of God. That oil carries the presence of God. So when the oil rests upon you, God begins to release the power in that oil. and it begins to walk on you. It begins to knock down.
Amen.
It begins to destroy. It begins to overturn. It begins to, you know, destroy and overturn everything that is against, that has been against you, because God has sent him specifically to do that. Praise the Lord. Somebody shout hallelujah. Somebody shout hallelujah. When you when the Spirit is at work, the Spirit of God also quickens you. In John chapter 6, verse 63, the Spirit of God quickens you. The Spirit of God quickens you. What does it mean to be quickened? It means to be alive. Hallelujah. He said, it is the Spirit that quickeneth. The flesh profited nothing. The words that I speak unto you, they are what? They're spirit and they're life. Hallelujah. The Word of God. If I was teaching you biology, if I was teaching you chemistry, if I was teaching you how to travel from Ajman to Dubai, my brothers and sisters, only a few people will be interested. Hallelujah. But if I'm teaching the Word of God, because the Word of God is not ordinary, the Word of God that is coming out proceeds out because the Spirit of God grants that enabling presence and grace. And then when it comes in contact with your heart, the Holy Spirit begins to interpret it in your heart. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
So no one can interpret the Bible by his own knowledge. The Holy Spirit has to help you understand. That's why, my brothers and sisters, you find after the meeting, they say, how many wants to give their lives? You find some people say, I want to give my life. All through the meeting, the Holy Spirit has been conversing with them. The Holy Spirit has been talking with them, has been showing them the areas where they have gone bad, and also have been showing them the consequences of their sin. And at the end of it, the Holy Spirit will say, you need to stand up and publicly declare that you belong to me. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
That's what happens. And then all of a sudden, a man of God prays for you, and there's a transfer of power from that man of God to your life. And you find that the problem that you have been experiencing vanishes. It's no more there. God has taken over. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And God will take over someone's situation.
Amen.
The words that I speak, they're what? They're spirit. They're spirit. Their spirit and word, life. God will bring your, he will give your body life.
Amen.
I curse every disease in your body.
Amen.
I curse that situation that has crippled your progress in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I make it impossible for the enemy to get access again into your life ever.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus. You have become an alien to the works of the enemy in the name of Jesus.
Yeah.
Somebody shout hallelujah.
Yeah.
I say you will not be stranded.
Yeah.
If ever you have been stranded, you will not be stranded again.
Yeah.
The God of heaven, the Alpha and Omega, the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star, the one who is alive forevermore, it will ensure that you are no longer stranded again.
Yeah.
Where there have been no way, and they have said no way, the God of heaven, because he's a God who is more than enough, he speaks a way where there is no way. God make a way for you. Severe debt, your debtor, and your life has been put under severe pain. Every time you see the debtor, every time Your line is miserable. In the name of the God that I serve, the God of Pastor Ian Deboi, the God of the Redeemed Christian Church, Church of God, deliver you from your enemy. He will send a way. He will make a way for you. You will be able to pay your debt. You will be able to pay your debt. Sisters, the Bible tells us, he says in Luke chapter 7, I will give you, when the Holy Spirit intervenes and begins to work, what the Holy Spirit does when he comes into a situation. Give me Luke chapter 7. Luke chapter 7, verse 11. And it came to pass the day after that he went into a city called Nain, and many of his disciples went with him, and much people. Now when he came near to the gate of the city, behold, there was a dead man being carried out, the only son of his mother. And she was a widow. And much people of the city was with her. And when the Lord saw her, he had what? He had compassion on her and said unto her, weep not. And he came and touched the bear, and they that bare him stood still. And he said, young man, I say unto you, arise! In the name of Jesus, in business you will arise. In your home you will arise. You will no longer be down. You will no longer be down. You will not be bottom. You will be top in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, I say arise. Please be seated. That woman, the Bible says, the devil cometh, John chapter 10, verse 10. The devil cometh for to do what? To kill, to steal, and to destroy. That is the threefold ministry of the devil. He comes to steal your joy. He comes to steal the things that are precious to you. He comes to disable you. He comes to make things hard and difficult. Jeremiah 29, he says, God has my thoughts in mind. He has me in mind. He says, God is thinking about me. He's thinking about you in order to get you to that destination of honor and beauty. Amen.
Amen.
But on the other hand, the devil cometh for to do what? To kill, to steal, and to destroy. Is God behind disease? Is God behind your misfortune? Occasionally, God leaves you because he has spoken to you severally and you refuse to hearken. So he leaves you, my brothers and sisters. But that's not that he's the one, he's the engineer behind your misfortune. Most of the time, the enemy is behind it. You also, out of your carelessness and out of your lack of diligence, you have brought most of the problems on yourself. But God is always merciful. Hallelujah. This particular situation, Jesus walked into that city. He was not being expected, but he walked into that city. And when he walked into that city, strangely enough, there was something that attracted his attention. Jesus is walking through this place. Amen. And about your life, something has attracted him. Amen. So he stood and said, what was the problem? And they explained that this woman,
She was a widow. Meaning what? She's lost her husband. The devil was not yet done with her. He was not yet done with her. And the devil reached out for his only son, her only son, and also took that son away. That also confirms the ministry of the devil. He cometh for to do what? To kill, to steal, and to destroy. But the Son of God came that we might have life. Hallelujah. And Jesus Christ came. And when he came, the Bible said he saw so many people sorrowful. And they were thronging. They were walking to the burial ground. And the Bible says he was moved with what? With compassion. My brother, I'd like to say to you by the Spirit of God, God has seen your problem. He has seen your